Yeah, thank you. My name's Kayode Aaron. I've been in South Africa for 16 good years. Before I left Nigeria, I got this passion in photography. So I do shoot part of my profession there. And also I do sell on the street because in South Africa, there are no jobs. That is the reality. There are no jobs and you have to create one for yourself. So at the area where I was in South Africa, I was in a rural area of Gauteng of South Africa, where I did my businesses and also imagine selling sweets, bananas, fruits and other things just to make end meet. So those were the things that I was doing. And also they have this part of the police that they call metro. This metro, at times they will come and take off your goods, which did not make it easy for you to earn a good living. Because if, for example, your goods were being taken towards the end of the month, that means you lost. Then you have to look for money to pay rent. And what you do, like when they took some of your things, which were not up to like 300, 400 worth of goods, now they will be asking you to come and pay 1,000. So that was part of stealing system, because how do you pay 1,000 for goods that is not worth more than 400? So these were the things.
Where are the people taking these goods from you people?
Yeah, actually they said they have been called the metros. They said we are not supposed to sell on the street. So from the part where I was coming from, actually was dominated with mixed foreigners. We've got the Senegalese, the Cameroonians, Nigerians, Zimbabweans, and a lot of nationalities living in Yuve. So, and actually, the municipality or the people tried to talk to the municipality to grant them the access to sell freely on the street, whereby even though they'll be asking for tickets to be issued so that you can be paying to make things comfortable. But really, they were not supporting that act. So the method will just come and take your things and your goods away. And so the foreigners, they were making, at my own area, they were making they create job for themselves just to survive. But the citizens of the country, many of them, they were jealous, they were lazy, you understand? This is their problem. They were actually lazy. So once you try to do some things which they did not think that it can provide money, but for them, it's like you are doing this, you are doing that. Imagine a citizen that when you employ him to work, after working for like 1 or 2 days, because they are fond of enjoyment so much, whereby they can go to the club or to the, they call it bar. They go to the bar to enjoy up to the extent that they've forgotten themselves that they'll be going to work the following day. And some of these people, they can even call their boss. Boss, I won't be coming. I've got babalasi. Babalasi is the word they use for being drunk. So imagine an employer telling his employee that, boss, I'm drunk, I can't come to work. Or they use other means to lie so that they won't go to work. So it was very bad.
How have you been affected with this xenophobic attack on foreigners?
We have been attacked. I was attacked. Was whereby so many of my goods, they have been destroyed. Not as I've told you, I was not having shops, because those who were having shops, their shops were being burgled. But from my own side, I lost my belongings from the little I was making on the street to make ends meet, because paying rent in my own area the rent was so much, because rent it was like 1,500, 2,000 rand, 2,500, 3,000, depending on how big the room was. And when you calculate the money, like 2,500 or 2,000 rand to Nigerian money, it's like 40 or 45,000 naira. You see, so which means that in some areas whereby if you are paying like 3,000 rand, which is like equivalent to like 60 or 70,000 naira, which you can use to pay for either 6 months or 1 year equivalent in Nigeria. So you could see that the situation in South Africa, it was not helping. It was not helping. So many of us that were into business, that were not doing maybe out of drugs or frauds, to make an end meet, it was not easy. It was not easy. Except maybe if you are doing otherwise.
There's this report about the crime rate in South Africa. What can you say about that?
Actually, the crime rate in South Africa, it was too much, or it's too much. Because actually, when we look at the world, crime rate in the whole world, it seems that South Africa will be number two or number three when it comes to crime rate. Because killing of human being is nothing to them. And at times we make it as a joke that bullet is 1 rand, bullet is 2 rand. So bullet of a gun is very, very cheap for them to go into the shop and buy bullets and kill anybody they want. So the crime rate is very cheap. The crime rate, as for me, the crime is being caused by the government, because the law of the country is very flexible. The law is very cheap. That now, if you are using a gun or you are killing somebody, the law says that you kill somebody. You don't kill somebody halfway, because it will be dangerous for you to shoot and don't kill. Because when you shoot and you don't kill, the person will come for you, or the person will be there for you at the court, which can take you to be jailed or imprisoned. But when you shoot and kill that person, yeah, you can imagine that within 1 or 2 months that person can come out, because the belief now is that somebody who is dead is dead. So the crime is very, very worse, very, and there's nothing being done. And as for me, I believe it's because of the law. In the area where I live in Yobe, the Zimbabweans, they hijacked all this area, because at night you can't go out alone. When you go out alone and get drunk or any other thing, even without getting drunk, they come in 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 to attack you. They can stab you, they can shoot you, they can take a stone and stone you, and nothing will be done. And as for me, the police also, they are not helping, because the police, which we are supposed to deal with the crime, they were not dealing with the crime. Many of them, they are like, they are friends to these boys. They know them. And also, maybe some Zimbabweans who have been born in that country for so long also were being employed into the police force. So imagine that they see themselves as, even though they are South African police, they see themselves as brothers. Imagine I'm a Nigerian being a South African police. So I will see my brothers as my brothers, even though I'm wearing the uniform. So they don't deal with the criminal act. The criminal act has been too much.
Okay, you said bullet is very cheap in South Africa. So anybody can walk into any ham shop and buy bullets. Is that how easy it was?
That was how it was, how easy it was in South Africa. Normally, not everybody has gone. But due to crime rates in South Africa, so let's say there are some guys that they are robbers, maybe they rob you, they take your gun, they took your gun, or maybe the police were involved in giving them guns. So because there was some time ago, maybe like 5 or 6 years ago, which the federal government granted amnesty, that if you are having gun that is not licensed, you are permitted to come and drop it. You will not be arrested. But yet nobody is dropping his, you understand? Or maybe after that one, some they get their guns through illegal ways. So many of these guns, they have been stolen from some owners now, which they are using as illegal guns. And bullets is very cheap. So as bullets is very cheap, it takes them it takes them nothing to go into the, because I believe if they are asking for the procedure of where you have your gun, your license, then it will be difficult for you to buy a bullet. So you can just walk into the into the shop that are selling guns. They sell you bullets, and you just go and go haywire to do some rubbish. And because government is not intervening, or because end of the day when you kill somebody dead, as I've told you earlier, you will come out because they will tell you that person is dead.
Okay, now
so far will be the person who is a foreigner, who is not having ID, which they call it identity card. So when you have ID, that means you can come out. But maybe when you are using passport or asylum, if as an example as a foreigner, that is when you can face the law. But that means those who are doing the shit, they are the citizens of those countries.
Okay, now that you are going back home, what are your expectations in Nigeria? What do you want to start doing?
Yeah, my expectations in Nigeria, I believe it is well, because after going out for so many years, going for green and pasture, will I say maybe I went to the wrong country? I didn't know. But my expectation is to come back to Nigeria, come back, relax myself, settle into the system, because I was born in Nigeria, so it is my country. What I just need is to come back, relax, settle myself back into the system and see the way forward. So they say that prayer can never be too much, because our parents back home, they will pray for him. Our wives back home, they will pray for him. The husband back at home will pray for him. The sisters and the brothers we let back at home, they will pray for him. So I know that he's receiving more blessings. He's receiving more prayers, because he has done so much for the country and for the citizens of Nigerians. You know, because this is not sort of an ethnic group. Because we see ourselves as a Nigerian. Maybe now it is we that we know Barrister Alex, maybe as an Igbo man. But back in South Africa, nobody knows him as an Igbo man. They will just tell you Nigerians have been evacuated by Nigerian federal government. So they don't know what is happening. So I pray that God will continue rewarding him as he humbles himself so much by helping others. God will help him and his family.
Okay, thank you very much for coming. Bless you.